Hi everyone, welcome to the Digital Media Experience Lab Gone Virtual. I'm Morgan Cool, and today we're going to be going through how to set up the Prusa slicer in order to get started on your contactless 3D printing request. So the first thing you're going to need to do is look up Prusa slicer online, and on Google it's the first link that pops up. And if we scroll down, you'll see Windows, Mac, and Linux. I'm on Windows, so that's what I'm going to download. But if you are on Mac or Linux, then make sure to download those. Today, I'll just be going through how to use the Windows one. Okay, so we're just about done downloading now, and it should open up. So you'll get this little message here saying allowing Prusa 3D setup. So you're going to click yes. Make sure that you allow administrative. And then we're also going to select English if that's your primary language. I'll be going through how to use it in English. And then you can put it in any directory that you would like. I'm going to put it in program files just for simplicity's sake. If we go to next, the only thing that you're going to need to download is the Prusa Slicer 2.2.0. So this is the version that you're going to need. Make sure that you have that version. I recommend downloading the Windows drivers. Just to help make things smooth, and you can go ahead and unselect the test objects for Mini. You can click next. I'm just going to call it Prusa 3D. Create a desktop shortcut, that's up to you, but I'm going to for this case, and then install. And then you'll get the installation wizard up. I'm going to click next. And we're going to allow, press install, and now it's going to download all of the drivers. You can see here everything is ready to go. So we're finished. You can decide whether or not you want to go through the tutorials. I'll just go over briefly how to set things up and what we'll need from you to do your 3D printing contactless. So we'll be going over that today, but I won't be going into it extensively. If you want to learn, you can go ahead and go into tutorials, or you can visit the community hub. I'm just going to deselect these because we're not going to go into those in this tutorial. Okay, so we're all downloaded. It's on my desktop. Now I'm going to open up Prusa Slicer. What I'm going to do while that's opening is I'm going to go onto a website called Thingiverse. Now, Thingiverse is a great website for getting all kinds of STLs. So STLs are basically the object file that you're going to need to use. So we can look up pretty much anything, like for example, a fidget spinner. I want a 3D object fidget spinner. So let's take this one for example. I'm going to go to Thing Files, and you'll see there's a .stl file. So what we need from you at the Digital Media Experience Lab is an STL file. If you give us any other kind of file, like a .obj or any other kind of file or a .step, we're not going to be able to take it. We're going to ask you for an STL. So make sure that you have an STL file, whether you've designed it yourself or you're getting it online. Then we're going to download it. And so now I have what will look like this on our slicer. All right, so going back to the Prusa slicer, we are opening it up for the first time, so it's going to go through the configuration wizard. So pay attention because this is very, very important. So we're going to go to next, not finish, and we are not going to be using the mini, we're going to be using the Mark 3. So we're not going to be using the mini, so deselect the mini if that's selected. Make sure there's no other printers selected. You're going to go to Mark 3, and then you're going to go to the original Prusa i3 Mark 3 0.4 millimeter nozzle. So when you get to this page, the only thing that should be selected is the 0.4 millimeter nozzle. So once you have selected, you can go ahead and click next. We're not going to click the SL1 printer either, and you don't have to select these. We're not going to define a custom printer setup. We're going to go to next, and the filament that we're going to choose. So this is another important part where you're going to be changing something. So you're going to click on PLA under the type of filament. You're going to click PLA, and all the different vendors will show up. From here, you're going to click Hatchbox. So PLA, Hatchbox, and it should be only one thing that pops up. Hatchbox PLA. So that's what you're going to have selected. Once that's selected, We're going to click next again. You can decide whether or not to have updates automatically. I'll just keep it on for now. And then this also is up to you whether or not you want to have that, but you don't need it. And then the view mode, put it to simple mode for now. That's all you'll need in order to prepare your file for getting it printed at the DME. So once you've done all of that, simple mode, now we can click finish. And it'll have everything set up for us. So we'll see the bed. You're going to be able to see your print settings. So you're going to want to make sure that it's on 0.1 millimeter quality. That's what we're going to be using. We're going to have hatchbox PLA. So make sure that under filament, you change it to hatchbox PLA. Printer, you're going to want to make sure it's the Mark III. You should only have the Mark III showing up here if you set it up properly. If for whatever reason you have more than one, just make sure that this one is selected. And then we're going to have the infill set to 15%. This is also very important. And that is pretty much your basics of what absolutely needs to be done for setting up your print. So in order to add your object, you're going to click the little add here and you'll see my file directory comes up. I'm going to click on downloads and I can see my STL file here. It's called Triplex Thingy. I'm going to press open and it's going to show up on the bed. So now we can see our 3D object and it's placed it on the actual bed of the printer in the slicer. And then you're going to want to check your object manipulation parameters. So specifically, you're going to want to make sure that your object is the exact size that you want it. So make sure to pull out a ruler, and look and say, okay, it's 74.77 millimeters. So that's about 7.5 centimeters. So it's going to be this big. So pull out your ruler and make sure that it's the size that you want it. And you can modify the size here. So you can either change directly the actual size of like one axis. So for example, if I want the maximum, width to be like 100 millimeters instead. So 10 centimeters, I'm going to click 100 and then click enter. And now you see it's made it bigger and it's changed the other measurements accordingly. Now, if you don't want it to scale uniformly, so in other words, you don't want it to scale with the X, Y, and Z all increasing at the same rate, you just want to maybe stretch it in one axis direction, you can unclick this little lock unlock here, and then you'll be able to just change one axis at a time. You'll see the two arrows there for just the one axis, so you'll see what that looks like. For example, if I'm only moving one, that's what it's going to look like. So make sure when you're doing it, that you have this little lock on, because then everything will be uniform. So once you've got your size set up, you've got support set for everywhere, infill at 15%, and we've got brim selected, we're going to go to slice now. And it'll slice it for you. So essentially what slicing is taking the 3D object and turning it into a bunch of 2D drawings stacked on top of each other, which can then be exported to G-code, which is essentially the instructions for the 3D printer. So the important part about after when you slice it is the sliced info. So you're going to want to pay attention to the normal mode estimated printing time. So for this example, it's 2 hours and 15 minutes. You're going to want to make sure that this estimated print time is under 6 hours, which is our maximum. If our maximum print time ever changes, you'll be alerted ahead of time and it should be in the Google form that you're filling out. So once you've got everything set up, we're making sure that we can see our size and scale factors. We can see your print thoroughly. You've got supports everywhere turned on, brim, infill 15%, and our print settings up here. What you're going to do is take a screenshot and you're going to upload that to the Google form in the link below. You don't need to click export G-code, and that's all you need to do. In the event that your estimated print time is over 6 hours, you're going to need to do one of two things. Either you need to select a model that's smaller, small enough that you can slice it in 6 hours. So how you would do this is you can decrease the size here and see if you can make it smaller and thus make the printing time lower. If you need it to be an exact measurement, Let's say you designed it yourself and it needs to be exactly 2 inches, for example, then you need to put it in CAD software and split it up into multiple parts. Print those multiple parts separately so that each part is under 6 hours, and then super glue them all together once you get them. Because unfortunately, the maximum print time is 6 hours, so we can't print anything over 6 hours. So that's what you're going to need to do in the event that it's over 6 hours print time. So now that you have it sliced, you've got your estimated print time, you're ready to go to the next step. If you have any other questions, feel free to send us an email at dme@ryerson.ca. We'd be happy to give you a hand with whatever you need help with. Thanks so much for watching, and good luck!